Good evening and welcome to the College of Complexes, located at 2901 West Edison Street in Chicago. My name is Tim and I'll be introducing everybody until Brom gets finished collecting the money for the tuition of this college, which is a $3 tuition.
Thank you.
Our College of Complexes consists of the following format. We'll have a brief announcements period, then we'll have our speaker who speaks for however long it takes him. Then we will have the a question and answer period. We request that your questions be questions and not a speech, because after the question period, you'll have a chance to get out up here for maybe 4 to 5 minutes and give a rebuttal. Generally, we're out of here by 8:45. Just another note that these proceedings are being recorded and that you can reach our recordings at the College of Complexes website, which is collegeofcomplexes.org. You can click on the link to videos and you'll see a complete archive for the last 6 years. You can also access them at my website, which is www.timsvideo.com. And I'd like to briefly talk about our speaker. Our speaker tonight is for the Chicago Chapter of Veterans for Peace. His motto is education, not militarization. The Chicago Veterans for Peace works to abolish war as an instrument of national policy, to counteract the perpetual drumbeat for war, to discuss opinions to conflicts resolution by violence, increase public awareness of the costs of war, restrain our government from intervening overtly and covertly in the internal affairs of other nations, and to reduce and eventually eliminate nuclear weapons. Ex-Army Ranger with 2 deployments to Afghanistan, published author Rory Fanning will speak about war and life in the military. His writings have appeared in The Guardian, The Nation, Mother Jones, Salon, Truthout, Common Dreams, etc. Rory is concerned about 10,000 students that are currently enrolled in the Junior Reserve Officers Training Corps, JROTC, in the Chicago public schools.
These guys are hard to follow. I don't know if I can do it. Well, thanks for having me, everybody. I appreciate it. My name is Rory Fanning. I'm going to start tonight by talking about why I signed up for the military, what I saw while I was in the military, and why I decided to leave. And I think the best place to start in this story is 9/11. I think that's a day that changed everyone's life in here. It certainly changed mine. When I saw those planes hitting the Twin Towers, I said that kind of thing can't happen again. And I want to do my part to prevent it. I had just graduated from college. I had a bunch of student loans to pay back. I also wasn't really excited about getting a job in a cubicle afterwards. And so the military seemed to check all those boxes. I was going to go off and fight for freedom and democracy, prevent terrorist attacks, pay off student loans, get a little adventure, avoid the cubicles, etc. So I signed up, and I right off the bat kind of had an understanding that when you join the military, you are less of a human being and more of a piece of equipment. And I was kind of okay with that. I got that. So I wanted to become the most expensive piece of equipment possible. So, which meant I needed to get as much training as possible. So I decided to try out for the Army Rangers, which is an entry-level special forces unit that specializes in taking airports and backing up Navy SEALs, Delta Force, and then the Special Forces, Green Berets, in the Army. So if they were going on a mission to grab someone or whatever, we would be in the front lawn in the event that something bad happened, and going in and help them. We'd also go to different parts of, you know, various challenging places they really couldn't get to on helicopter and had to kind of march up to, and none of the other units were willing to do it, so we would always volunteer for that type of thing. So I enlisted. Training was largely boring. A lot of boot polishing, a lot of food and sleep deprivation, plenty of challenges. I was actually pretty good at the job. I won the physical fitness award for the Ranger Indoctrination Program. when I entered. Did the most push-ups, sit-ups, and fastest two-mile run.
Wow.
I was just generally good at being a ranger, and I liked it. Before I knew it, I was landing in Afghanistan. This was on Christmas Eve of 2002. Yeah, that's when I was landing. Or 2003, yeah. So I landed kind of expecting bullets to be whizzing by my head as we landed. It was about 2 o'clock at night. It was warm, very warm, despite being Christmas. And it was quiet. Smell of fruit in the air, a lot of dust in the air. Went to bed, woke up the next morning, and was startled by the level of poverty that I saw all around me. We were in Kabul. We were just building our military bases in Bagram Air Force Base, which is about a 20-minute Humvee ride into Kabul. In Kabul, there was gaping holes in the buildings. You saw Russian tanks kind of littering the landscape, Russian planes littering the landscape. People pushing, you know, 19th century fruit carts down the road, you know, barrels of fire burning the breakfasts of various people that morning. Stunning level of poverty. So we actually went out on a mission the first or second day, and I saw this woman, and she was digging this really gaunt bush, just pounding away at the tough dirt. We came back a few hours later, and she was still digging. I asked our translator what she was doing. Oh, she does that every single day. That's how she gets the fuel to cook her family's meal each night. So I kind of had an idea what I was stepping into. We started going on missions. We would land in a person's front yard, storm into the front yard, put a bag over the person's head, and run them off to a place like Guantanamo or an overseas equivalent in Afghanistan, in their own country. Obviously no due process, no attorneys present, etc. We just were following orders. This just didn't happen once or twice. It happened pretty regularly that we did this. What I come to find out later is that more often than not, the people that we were storming into their homes and putting bags over their head were basically little more than pawns in village disputes, I would say. When you are living in Afghanistan, a country that has been embroiled in civil war for as long as it's been embroiled in, a country that has been occupied for as long as it's been occupied, there's a lot of desperate people in the country. And when they saw this occupying power coming in with millions of dollars at their disposal and saying, hey, tell me where the enemy is, many people came forward, came out of the woodwork and said, I can tell you where the enemy is. My next door neighbor. And we would give that person a few thousand dollars, take the neighbor away. Not only would they get a few thousand dollars, but they would get their neighbor's property. And of course, people sitting here tonight, you know, how would you do such a thing? I guess you kind of have to live that kind of life and be that desperate to feed your family to maybe make those kinds of decisions. We're also, you know, out there kind of looking for things to do. I didn't know at the time that the Taliban had surrendered 3 months before we actually arrived in the country. The initial wave by the Special Forces and the Air Force, there's a fantastic book by Anand Gopal that details this, called No Good Men Among the Living, that everybody should read. It was a Nobel Pulitzer Prize winner last year, finalist. I said winner, but it was a finalist. No Good Men Among the Living by Anand Gopal. He writes for The Atlantic. He just wrote an incredible piece for The Atlantic last week about the Syrian civil war. But he details how the Taliban surrendered a few months after 9/11. They raised their hands and said, hey, we want none of the special forces. We want none of the Air Force coming in. But unfortunately, that wasn't really good enough for our politicians. You know, we had just seen 9/11. They wanted heads, you know. We're also used to Cold War era military budgets, and it's pretty profitable to conduct a war. You know, we spend about $700 billion a year on our military. So we were essentially there to draw the Taliban back into the fight. So in a lack of a clear-cut objective, we kind of invented one. So we'd go off. Schools make incredible staging bases for military operations. We'd climb up to about 10,000 feet and see a village of about 30,000 people at 10,000 feet. And we told the kids going to school in this village that classes were canceled. Well, they'd say, for how long? Well, until we say they're back on. So we'd sit there, relatively bored most days. We'd have rockets land in our tents every once in a while, and no one ever really knew where they came from. So someone would say, well, where did that rocket come from? Well, that general vicinity over there. And we'd call in the Air Force, and they'd drop a 500-pound bomb in that general vicinity over there. We'd launch artillery rounds in that general vicinity over there. We know now that, you know, the conservative effort estimate of about 1 million people have been killed since 9/11. A conservative amount, 80% of those people being non-combatants. And it was because of that type of response while we were overseas. We'd also sit there in the school, you know, looking for things to do. All these hyper, you know, high testosterone Rangers looking to actually do what they were sent over there to do. So we'd watch two military-aged men walk across the school. They didn't show a proper level of deference. We'd grab both of them, put one in one room, put one in the other room, and the one who was a little too cocky would hear a gunshot. They would hear screams, and he would think that we had just killed his friend. You know, and this was a pretty regular occurrence. And it wasn't just, you know, the gunshots, it was in the actual, there was actual screams from torture. You know, I had signed up, you know, to prevent another terrorist attack like 9/11. But by the missions that we were going on, based on horrible intelligence, village disputes, you know, drawing people into the fight, people who walked, innocent people, who were being, you know, retaliated against for these random RPGs launched into our camps. I was basically making the condition, creating the conditions for more terrorist attacks. And so I decided I couldn't be a part of that anymore. We know now that between 1980 and 2001, there were 293 suicide bombers in the world, suicide bombs, in that 21-year period. 10% of those were directed at the U.S. or U.S. interests. Since 2003, there's been over 2,500 suicide bombs around the world. 90% of those aimed at the U.S. or U.S. interests. Mm-hmm. So we were, in fact, making the world more dangerous. And that's not what I signed up for. So I decided that I had to leave the military. And I became one of the first war resistors from the Ranger Regiment in the post 9/11 era. And that was probably the most challenging part of being in the military. You hear of the military bonds that are created by soldiers in combat zones, etc. But to have all those people turn on you was a completely different experience. Because I wasn't just questioning the mission, I was questioning these men and what they stood for. So they took it incredibly personally. So I spent, you know, because there weren't any Rangers who were becoming war resistors, conscientious objectors at the time, they had no idea what to do with me. So I sat in a limbo state for about 6 months, washing dishes, painting curbs, absorbing the general ridicule of my chain of command, and getting the silent treatment essentially from all of my Ranger buddies. There was two people during that time that weren't afraid to talk to me. Weren't afraid to be seen with me at the cafeteria or in the dining hall. And that was Kevin Tillman and Pat Tillman. Pat Tillman gave up a $3.6 million NFL contract playing with the Arizona Cardinals to join the military. And him and his brother Kevin, the first time I saw Pat was on the cover of People magazine. First time I met Pat, I was coming out of a training exercise, heading off to a bar. Everybody else was off, couldn't wait to get drunk. I walk by a coffee shop on the way to the bar, and I see Pat and his brother. I decide I want to go in there and introduce myself. Pat and his brother loved reading, and they loved writing. And for fun, they would write 3 to 5 page papers on the topic of their choice. And I think when I saw them, they had just written and were discussing the Israeli-Palestinian conflict while everybody else was out getting drunk. In an environment that doesn't really encourage critical thinking, which the military is that place, it was incredibly refreshing to sit down and talk to Pat and Kevin about any number of things. And what was really interesting about Pat was when I talked, he listened. You know, most people that you talk to can't wait to tell you what they know about something. You know, here was Pat, this millionaire, someone who had just gotten straight A's through graduate school at Arizona State, had a dream job, you know, looked like a Greek statue, you know, who was actually interested in what I had to say about the world. It was really, really refreshing. And we would go on to have, you know, more than a dozen conversations after that. I was really, really dependent on, you know, talking to him and, you know, because he was this person who wasn't afraid to talk to me. And also this hero, the poster boy for the war on terror in a lot of ways. And so this went on for about 6 months. I was expecting to go to jail or expecting to go to the Army to be a bullet stopper. That's what they called, in the Rangers, they called everybody in the larger military bullet stoppers. And I thought that would be my fate. And so I get called down to formation thinking, okay, this is the day. I'm going to jail, or at the very least being sent to a different unit. But I was told in formation that Pat Tillman was killed the previous night. He died in an enemy ambush. He died a hero, fighting for his platoon. And I was stunned. I mean, this is the one person that kind of stood by me when no one else would. But I didn't really have anybody else to talk to about it. So I went back up to my room and just kind of waited, feeling incredibly sad. I get called down the following day, and they said, all right, Fanning, pack your bags, you're leaving the military. I was stunned. No army, no jail, no long discussion, and I was basically out of the military and processed out within 6 days on my birthday. I think it was my 24th birthday. And so I went back to Montana, not really knowing what to do. I certainly wasn't going to talk to my family about what happened to me. I came from a very right-wing Catholic family who liked the idea that the U.S. was fighting for freedom and democracy around the world, as opposed to creating the conditions for more terrorist attacks. So I didn't say anything. I was kind of scared. And I sat there in Montana, kind of scared to go out into the rest of the world to even find a job, because it was kind of a traumatic experience, not only my time in the military, but also kind of the transition out. And so about 30 days went by, and I was sitting at another bar, and I saw that Pat wasn't in fact killed by in an enemy ambush. He was killed by his own men. Oh, thanks. And so it was being covered up all the way to the highest levels of the U.S. government. At the very least, Donald Rumsfeld knew that Pat was killed by his own men. And I think that's kind of why I was let out of the military so easily. I called the Inspector General based on kind of my situation. They're covering up Pat's death, and they just ushered me out. So I had to go get a job, so I got a job at a bank. I spent 5 years at this bank in the cubicle that I kind of dreaded. Didn't tell anybody about my experience. And I said, that's not the kind of life I want to live. I don't want to live half of a person. But I'm also not really confident enough to say anything about my experience publicly. So I got to do something big, you know, to kind of shake things up. So I was, you know, the cardinal sin of leaving the military is leaving your range of buddies. And I was constantly screamed at for, you know, leaving my range of buddies behind. How dare you break this promise? How dare you break this oath? You can't leave your buddies. So I decided to walk across the country for the ranger buddy who was there for me when no one else was. So I decided to walk across, starting at Virginia Beach, going all the way to San Diego to raise the $3.6 million that Pat gave up when he left the Arizona Cardinals for the Pat Tillman Foundation. And I walked for about 8 months, walked 3,300 miles, went through 5 pairs of shoes. Initially started, you know, slept behind Targets and Walmarts and cemeteries and all these, because I didn't really plan it at all. I spent 2 weeks planning it, but I just knew I had to go. And eventually I started getting a little bit more confidence. I started calling schools. I started talking to prisons. I even called newspapers in towns I would get to. It took me about a month to do this. And then people started inviting me into their homes, not just for a night, not just for even a week, but for 2 weeks. You know, I spent Christmas and New Year's with family in Arkansas. Incredible, incredible people across this country. And I really realized that people do the absolute best to make this world a better place with the information they have access to and the limited free time that they can afford, because a lot of people are working really hard in this country just to put food on their table. And so I had an amazing experience. But my talks in these schools and these prisons were largely apolitical. I was trying to encourage people to make decisions similar to the ones Pat did when he gave up all that money, because I knew that there was a huge imbalance in this country and we needed people to make more decisions like Pat. And so I was trying to appeal to people's better interests and better sides to make more decisions like Pat. I was pretty naive at the time. But I also wasn't talking about my time in the military. And I finished the entire walk not talking about my time in the military. So I go back to Chicago and say, okay, you did this thing, but it still doesn't feel like you finished what you're supposed to do. So I decided to retrace my steps via history books. I walked where Nat Turner had his slave uprising. I walked where Ida B. Wells wrote her anti-lynching papers. I walked where the San Patricio Battalion laid down their weapons and refused to fight in the Mexican-American War, the San Patricio Battalion being a bunch of Irish immigrants who related more to the Mexicans than they did to the brass that were telling them to fight to acquire basically the entire Southwest. I walked where Dolores Huerta organized farm workers, etc. And so I started collecting all these stories and writing, you know, 1,000 words on them. And, you know, what I did relative to what they did was pretty small. I mean, these were conscientious objectors of a different sort. And so I wanted to tell their story, and I knew by telling their stories, I would find the confidence to tell mine. So I put all this stuff down, all the incredible exchanges I had with people, what it was like leaving the military, all of this history into this book, Worth Fighting For. And it came out last November 2014, and a year and a half. And that process of writing the book gave me the confidence to go out and talk about my experience. And I happen to live in a very good place to talk about my experience. Chicago has 10,000 students enrolled in the junior ROTC program, where up to 40% of the kids who graduate go off to fight in the military, depending on the branch that they enlist in. And my idea was, you know, not to go there and wag my finger at these kids who largely see the military as a thing to get them to college paid for, get out of poverty, and they're kind of a life raft for their situation. So I don't go into these schools that I talk to and say, hey, don't join the military. I just try to say, hey, consider the whole picture before you decide. Full disclosure is my idea. Tell these kids as much as possible. Because when you talk to these kids, they know nothing about the last 14 years. They know nothing about Vietnam. They know nothing about any of our coups. No, they know nothing about the history of the U.S. military in a large regard. And my job is just to at least tell my story, tell a little bit of what I know about the history of the U.S. military, and allow them to make the most informed decision possible. Because there's nothing worse than killing someone for a cause you don't understand or ultimately don't believe in. And I know plenty of guys who can't leave their basement because of what they did, and they can't process or understand why they did what they did. And if you're going to ask these kids, you know, 95% of the kids that are signed up in this JROTC program are Black or Latino. They come from the poorest sides of the city, the south and west side. These kids should at least have a full picture of what they're getting into before they go. We have 10,000 recruiters walking the hallways in this country, working with a $700 million a year advertising budget. Not to mention all the movies like Black Hawk Down, American Sniper, etc., that kind of give a one-sided perspective on what war is like. You know, a lot of kids ask me, you know, is the military like Call of Duty, one of the most popular, you know, single-shooter military video games out there? Is it like this movie? And I was like, well, is Call of Duty, do babies scream when they watch their mom or dad get killed in front of them? Because that's what it's like. Are the majority of the people dying in Call of Duty civilians? No, not really. Can you turn off Call of Duty? Yes. Well, you can't really turn off war. You know, so yeah, there's a lot of differences between Call of Duty, the movies, and the realities of war. And you should know about those before you make this decision. So, you know, there's plenty of things to talk about on this end. So if you guys want to, we can open it up and discuss. I think that would be fantastic. Thank you for listening. And that's it.
Wow.
Good job. Good job.
Okay.
Well, we've got questioners. Let's see. Yeah, Libby, right. First.
Oh, yours, Mother.
What happened to Kevin? Tell me.
Kevin is living in Arizona with a few kids.
Did he stay in the military?
He finished his tour. He went to sniper school, but was disillusioned. But he had to see his tour through, and he's an amazing guy. He's one of the only guys I still stay in touch with. I talk to his mom pretty regularly.
So Pat, was he ordered killed, or was it just friendly, or was it friendly fire?
Well, that's...
There's still a lot of questions about how Pat died and why he died. What we do know for sure is that it was covered up to the highest levels of the government. So,
are we past 12? Official stories so far from the Pentagon and what happened to them? Are
that's
we past
another question?
Well?
Raise your hand.
I'm sorry. All right.
Oh, thank you.
Bobo?
Sorry. Yes.
Yeah, you look familiar. Were you on Democracy Now?
No. I get mistaken for Jeremy Scahill every once in a while.
Yeah.
It's a beard.
I did mistake you for him.
Yeah.
I thought you were on Democracy Now.
No, I work for Haymarket Books, and we publish all of Amy Goodman's stuff. I don't know, maybe an image of leadership, but I've never been interviewed on that, unfortunately. It's a great program. It's my favorite. So.
All right. Eliana?
Thank you so much. When you meet Russians, I speak Russian. When you meet some Russian soldier, they were kind of aggressive or friendly, those Russian guys.
The Russians were gone by the time we've gotten there. I mean, basically, the Russians invaded in 75, and they were there through, I think, 85. I mean, I think that was kind of their Vietnam.
Yeah.
You saw a lot of Russian-looking kids because there was a lot of rape and a lot of torture, and there was a lot of horrible things that happened during the Russian occupation. And we funded the resistors, and the resistors turned into Taliban, essentially. You know, we called them... Yeah, the greatest freedom fighters since their founding fathers is what Ronald Reagan said. Yeah, I didn't know. So.
All right, Pat Butler.
Yeah, you were a minority of one in your ranger unit. You guys all probably came from similar backgrounds. You certainly had the same indoctrination that you went through during training. What do you think was the difference between you and the 195 other men in your unit who didn't take your course of action?
Yeah, that's a great question. You know, what was the difference? I mean, Pat had similar questions. Kevin had similar questions. A feeling of betrayal. I might say one thing was that I felt like I had options. Were I to leave? I just graduated from the University of Notre Dame, and not a lot of other kids had graduated college. I think there is a really strong emphasis on being apolitical in the military and not looking towards larger ideas beyond the guys to your right and left. Your Ranger buddies are the most important thing, and it's all about your Ranger buddies. And I just said, well, this is a downward spiral if, you know, I stay in for my Ranger buddies, because we're creating the conditions for more attacks, and we're going to lose more Ranger buddies. And if we collectively all put our weapons down at the same time and decided to go home, then that's kind of the best way to look out for your Ranger buddies. So, I mean, that's a great question, and I know a lot of guys felt very disappointed and betrayed by what they saw in Afghanistan. But it's an entire culture that you're moving against. And I basically had to put my head down and say, this is what I'm going to do. Yeah, I mean, I think about that a lot today. Why did I do this relative to other guys?
Paul?
Paul Brewer.
Young lady, go ahead.
Were most of the other Rangers, were they your age? Were they, you know, 18, 19, or what?
One of the reasons I signed up for the military is because mostly 18-year-olds were signing up, and I thought people with real life experience, 21-year-olds like myself, should go off and fight.
Mature.
But it was largely 18-year-olds. There was 19, a few college graduates, but not many. But after 9/11, I think there were plenty of people in college who signed up, wanted to do their part.
Well, what age do you think that young men in our culture begin to really think about what they do for real? I mean, as far as consequences, really make a more thought out process. Is it at an older age, like 21, or is it more?
I think, you know, there's not a huge difference between, you know, 16-year-olds and, you know, 21-year-olds. I think people are 50-year-olds, you know. I think we all do the best with the information we have access to. Education certainly allows you to think more critically about things. And the less education you have, the less critical you're going to be. And so I think, you know, whenever you feel like, you know, I don't know, you become more conscious, I think, with education. So, yeah.
Okay. Wes Weiger and then Joe Sober.
I suppose when you got there, it had long declined as a tourist destination. I think at one point there was a Kabul built.
Yeah, it was. I mean, there's gaping holes in most buildings in Kabul. I knew it was a place where, you know, Bohemians went and toured, and it was a great place in the 60s. It was, you know, very politically engaged, a strong socialist movement actually in Afghanistan in the 60s. Yeah, it was far from that. Kite Runner is a good book that kind of highlights all that transformation.
Joe? Yeah, I got a question. I'm kind of curious. You said you were a graduate of Notre Dame. Why didn't you become an officer? Why enlist as a grunt, basically?
Yeah, because when you become an officer, you don't have a choice on where they send you. As an enlisted person, you could decide, I want to be a Ranger. I just saw the movie Black Hawk Down after 9/11, and I knew that I could try out for the Rangers and go in there and do it. So I could have become like a supply officer, you know, if that's what they wanted me to do. So you actually have more control over your destiny as an enlisted person.
Should have watched the whole movie. Oh, man.
Mike Lehman. Should you get into politics, you make a lot more sense than the people I've been listening to the last year. How long were you in Afghanistan for?
Well, I did a tour of 9 months, and then what I didn't have to say in the story was that's when I decided I wanted to be a war resister. And they basically told me, sorry bitch, you're gonna walk with the donkeys. And they took me the next day to Afghanistan in a supply role. And I spent 3.5 months, 4 months, you know, in a supply role, being the outcast. It wasn't just the cafeteria, it was actually in Afghanistan, in a combat zone, where I was the outcast. And, you know, they would all sleep inside the school, and I slept outside, you know, in the snow.
What should America have done in Afghanistan? Whatever the mission was, to find Bin Laden, I suppose. Why were we there?
Bin
Laden was there?
Yeah, I mean, we know that 16 of the 20 hijackers were Saudi. You know, it would maybe make sense to go after Saudi Arabia, our closest ally, in the war, if you're even going to do it. But at the very most, it could have been a police mission to find this one person, not declare war against an entire community.
Bin Laden, right?
Bin Laden was also not even found in Afghanistan. He was found in Pakistan, outside of a major city, which we probably knew all along. But it's hard to justify a $600 to $700 billion a year military budget, you know, if you catch the guy, you know, soon after. I don't know why, you know, it took so long. It's just speculation. But, yeah.
So we should have been there just searching, not bombing and shooting up the place.
Well, evidenced by how...
Billy Fisher.
Wait.
I mean, the world is no safer now. The Taliban has just as much territory as they had before we went in, currently. There is, you know, the suicide bombs have skyrocketed across the country, you know. Meanwhile, we're closing 50 schools here in Chicago. Our infrastructure is falling apart. You know, we're spending $1 trillion a year on our military. We're also, you know, neglecting some very basic things.
Can you see me here?
Yeah,
I'm Marty, and I teach college-level psychology. And I have had several students who have had difficulty coming to class and who have said that when they were separated from the military after serving their release, that they were handed a paper bag full of medication saying, you have post-traumatic stress disorder, take this. And I had a student who couldn't leave his house for 3 months. So what I'm curious about, first of all, I'd like to know your comment on people being diagnosed without having had an actual time with the doctor. But secondly, do your detractors accuse you of having PTSD, and that's why that you're saying these nutty things like, well, you know, we shouldn't be in this war?
That's what my dad particularly likes to think. You know, he likes to sign off on it as being a mental illness. You know, and whatever. But yeah, I think.
Your dad thinks you have a mental illness?
Yeah. He's a Trump supporter and lives in Montana. So, you know. Anyway,
I think he has a mental illness.
But that's a really important question about, you know. Can you just ask that one more time, the question?
Well, like I said, they have many students who have had this diagnosis without having actually met with someone who could assess them. So, comment about the diagnosis of PTSD, but also, do your detractors accuse you of having experienced these things, and that's why you're saying nutty things like the war is wrong?
Yeah. Well, I think people, you know, if they were serious about treating post-traumatic stress, they would make it way easier for soldiers who are coming back to talk about their experiences. Because if they felt like they were their entire person was embraced after they came back, I think they would be able to deal with this a lot better than any kind of medication was, which is basically sweeping dirt under the rug, I think, with these medications. And there's skyrocketing, you know, we talk about supporting the troops, but, you know, and we bring people out in concerts and baseball games, but if they're really serious, they would bring soldiers out at halftime and let them talk for 20 minutes in front of 40,000 people about their experience. I can't even get in front of a high school or in Chicago. You know, it's next to impossible for me to talk to these kids. And I think that is the only way. I mean, some damage can't be undone and some scars can't be healed. And I think a lot of people see that, you know, with their post-traumatic stress, their moral injury, et cetera. But I think the only way to navigate out of that, you know, if it's going to happen, is by feeling embraced fully by your community and being allowed to speak about your experiences anytime you want. you know, in any situation. And I think, to me, that's what supporting the troops are. And and it's, you know, if you can label someone a basket case, it's easy to dismiss their politics too. So yeah.
Billy Fisher.
I have a question. I can't forget what I was going to ask already. However,
I'll call it.
Seen a lot more than most people in the States will see. And because of what's going on in the world today, and I know it's a question that nobody can answer. However, how do we defend ourselves against these insane idiots that go up ISIS and that ilk? Something's got to be done. I mean, they're so fucking out of control. And this is 2016. You would think that the race, our race, could have been elevated to a higher level, but it's not. It's never going to happen. And there's always going to be war because people seem. Well, there's money, yes.
Well,
but I mean, what do you do, in your opinion, if you have any ideas on how you protect yourselves? What do you do against, I would think, you know, with all our resources and with all the covert operations, a small band could just go in and start, boom, assassinating without involving a huge infrastructure of young men.
That's why that book, No Good Men Among the Living, is really good. No Good Men Among the Living by Anand Gopal is really good because he basically is the first person to talk about the war in Afghanistan in the eyes of actual Afghans. And what you see is when you are basically denied opportunities to get jobs, you're invaded, you're occupied, basically fighting is your only means to put food on the table. And most of the people who are fighting in ISIS right now laid down their weapons and walked up to the U.S. and said, okay, we surrender. The main people fighting ISIS in ISIS right now were members of Saddam's military. When the debathification of Saddam's army and imposed a Shia dictator that basically ethnically cleansed all the Sunni in Iraq, they had no choice but to fight. And it's a lot easier to fight when there's something on the other side of death. And that's where you see the extremists coming from. Right now there is zero opportunity for anybody in Iraq right now because of US meddling in the country and around in Afghanistan. And what one thing we know from these last 14 years is that military and violence only begets more violence. And we're only continuing this process. We're not neutralizing anything. We're making matters worse by targeting civilians and giving people no choice but to fight. That's what we've done in Afghanistan. That's what we've done in Iraq. That's what we've done in Libya by regime change over there. The military is not going to protect us from anything, only make us less safe, as we've seen by the number of suicide bombs that have happened since 2003.
So what you're saying is if we pulled everybody out of everywhere and just concentrated on the problems here in the States, that we would be left alone?
I believe in national sovereignty. I believe that people should be able to decide for themselves what happens in their own country. The U.S. is obsessed with regime change and controlling the natural resources of other countries and having spheres of influence in various regions. I think they're in quagmires and they don't know how to get out of it at the time. But I think, yes, that would go a long way. If we spent the amount of money that we spent on our military, just first on our population, but if we're serious about bringing peace to these regions, we invest in these countries, give people jobs, etc. Maybe let them control the oil that we've been stealing from them for 100 years. You know, these are just a few ideas off the cuff that seem better than military, endless war, and etc.
I agree.
Anders.
You said a minute ago, and the question I have, you said I have trouble getting in front of high school, you know, groups to talk to them. Is that because you can't personally give the speeches? I mean, you don't feel like it? Or are the high school administrators telling you they don't want you coming in talking to their students? What's happening there? Why aren't you giving presentations like this to groups of high school students that are hearing the opposite from the recruiters?
I actually applied for a grant for the Chicago Teachers Union, sponsored by Veterans for Peace, to talk to 12 high schools, and I had a year to talk to 12 high schools. I got on message boards, I sent out Facebook messages, I wrote articles saying how available I was. I actually got in to a few. Ernie's son invited me to talk, gave a glowing recommendation. I spoke at a few other schools, got glowing recommendations. Because I don't moralize, I don't wag my finger, I just talk about full disclosure. And I know tons of people, but people are scared. You know, there's attacks on, teachers. You know, ROM's closing 50 schools. They're doing everything possible to privatize education, and teachers are nervous. And they don't want to bring somebody who's, maybe questioning the narrative of largely popular program, the JROTC. You know, in the absence of real jobs, the military is a fine option for a lot of these students. And most, principals and administration think, that shouldn't be, questioned. And so it's a question not of my eagerness and willingness, it's a question of people's willingness to have it.
Charlie, did you ever get your question?
That's all right, there's others.
Okay,
I have a question, sir, just so you know.
I'm thinking of joining up.
What's your attitude towards your former teammates? Are you sympathetic towards them, or have you turned against them?
No, I'm sympathetic, none of them are billionaires, A lot of people, create an identity around something. I think, it took me 10 years to even talk about my experience. I realize how difficult it is in a society that is so pro-military to question the military. And I'm very sympathetic to them, even though I know a lot of them, after seeing what they saw, do. And even if you do question it, you take every opportunity to put food on your family's table. And, there are small benefits from being in the military, but if you're an outspoken critic, you're less likely to get those benefits, less likely to get those jobs, etc. So, there's a whole number of reasons why people don't speak out, and then, anybody,
All right, Butler?
Yeah, one of the things that you mentioned early on, you were talking about the fact that some of your teammates were beating up and in some cases torturing some of the locals because they had nothing better to do. Who was providing the adult supervision at the time? I mean, it's always been my impression that, doctrine is that torture produces very little in the way of tangible results. I knew a guy who was in the German army, he was an officer, and he wouldn't allow his men to torture anybody. Not that he was such a great humanitarian, it was just a waste of time. They weren't going to tell anything valuable. Who was watching the troops and keeping them on course while this stuff was going on?
I don't know, the President of the United States at the time.
I mean the officers.
Right, well, the Commander-in-Chief was an endorser of torture at the time, and he's allegedly, the final, representative of, larger society and, the adult. and this is the President who endorsed torture. Dick Cheney endorsed torture. I mean, Donald Rumsfeld endorsed torture. Barack Obama hasn't closed Guantanamo Bay. And there's still waterboarding, So you talk about adults, you go up to the highest, the best, most qualified adult, and they're saying torture works. So if they're saying it, it makes a lot of sense that their underlings are going to do what they do.
Which they ordered.
Bill Speck,
thank you.
Roy, what difference do you think might have, let me put it another way, if we hadn't eliminated the draft after the Vietnam War, where do you think we would be at today? My opinion is, there's no way we'd be in Afghanistan or Iraq. Because if my neighbors on my leafy green street had to send their kids off in a rifle company, the thing would be over in a week. So you got these kids from the inner city and Tulsa or wherever that are all gung-ho and they want to go, and then you got these North Shore kids, it's like it didn't even happen.
Yeah, that's a good question, and I think, you know, the draft would still be in place if it was politically viable, and they did see that students, you know, large numbers of students marched during the Vietnam War because they didn't want to go off and die. We also know that there's plenty of exceptions to the draft. You could buy your way out for any kind of reason. The wealthier you were, the less likely you were going to go overseas. So yeah, the draft is definitely something that doesn't exist anymore. But I don't necessarily know if that would be the solution. Ultimately, if we brought back the draft, I mean, Israel still has a draft, and you know, everybody, they're in constant state of endless war, you know, repressing Palestinians. So I don't know. I think you would definitely see more people in the street. But we also saw the largest mobilization of people in the history of the world in 2003 without a draft in opposition to the Iraq War, and we went anyway. You know, the draft also brings people who really don't want to fight into the fight, and we saw a lot of fragging, you know, where soldiers kill their officers. You know, there was a lot of chaos in the military as a result of the draft, and I think that's one of the big reasons. Number one, the Vietnam War ended, but also one of the reasons this is not happening now. Because the politicians can kind of ignore the protests, but they can't really ignore soldiers who are going to sabotage the mission while they're there. I just don't want to stop it. Bring, you know, the question, if we brought that back to draft for the war, would it, you know, fighting would stop.
Okay, Bill Wendt?
That was basically my question. There's a radio report the other day that there's a bill in Congress to restore the draft and draft women, too.
That's been passed.
All right, sir.
Two things. Number one, the draft does exist now in a different form. It's the economic draft. Kids get out of school, they've got no draft, can't get into college, can't get a job. What else are they going to do? Hang around the corner or get a gun or whatever. Second thing, since you can't get into schools, what's your life like now? Do you have a cubicle? Or are you writing another book? Or what's going on?
I work for Haymarket Books, which is a book publisher. I just finished writing another book. It's called Long Shot. Craig Hodges won two championships with the Bulls, won three straight NBA titles. He emailed my office and said he would like to write a book but didn't know where to start. And I sat down and wrote with him. This guy was blackballed from the NBA by leading a boycott against Nike. He went to the White House and said we need to do more to fight economic inequality and racism. He challenged Michael Jordan on a whole number of levels. Michael Jordan and the Bulls basically ran him out. He's got a ton of other great stories. Incredible stories. So I just finished writing that book. That'll be out soon. But I work for Haymarket Books. I, you know, work with Veterans for Peace. You know, trying to get out and talk to schools. I write articles, etc.
Hey, Aaron.
My hand is getting tired.
Yeah.
Rory, did you and Kevin, or you and Kevin and Pat, ever talk about conscience objection and leaving the military? Was that any part of your discussion?
I talked to Kevin afterwards about it, and he said, you know, Pat felt like he was in a very high-profile position, and you know, it made it very difficult for him to make decisions maybe similar to mine. He definitely was questioning the mission. You know, he was on the front lawn when Jessica Lynch was, you know, that whole commercial for the war happened. He saw how it was completely fake. You know, he saw what was happening in Iraq. He believed the war in Iraq was completely illegal. He had set up a meeting with Noam Chomsky, you know, after he got out of the military. So he definitely had his doubts. And
did the military know that he had his doubts?
Oh, possibly. Yeah.
Definitely.
Okay. Joe Soper. Joe has kids who've been in Afghanistan. So,
and going back too, I might add. My question is this: you before said that massive violence only gets you more massive violence. In that case, my question is, why haven't Japan and Germany started waging war again, seriously, against the Western world. Because obviously, they seem to have gotten quite pacified.
Yeah. Well, that's a good question. We also, through the Marshall Plan, basically completely funded those countries afterwards. If they were left in complete utter desperation afterwards without any future, I think we spent more on Japan and Germany after the war than we spent on our own country as far as infrastructure and development. But if you left them in a state that were leaving the people in the Middle East, then I could, you know, there's no difference between, you know, us 100,000. We've all been evolving for 100,000 years. Our brains are pretty much the same, you know, but it's the material conditions that we're surrounded by that allow us to make our future decisions. And I think you probably would have seen the same thing in Germany and Japan. Japan was completely devastated by the war, but we rebuilt it. Germany, you know, was completely devastated, we rebuilt it.
Okay, Tim. Oh, David.
David first and then me. Well,
yes, how do you feel, the subject has already come up to some extent, how do you feel about women serving in combat positions and also about the possibility of women being drafted?
I don't think anybody should be serving in combat positions via the U.S. military. This is an imperial power that has got imperial missions. I do believe men and women should be treated equal in all capacities, but I don't necessarily think that it's an actual win for women, you know, because they're serving in the military. Because what the U.S. military has proven is that, you know, we go off and kill women and children, you know, women overseas, you know, so it's like, you know, how are you advancing the cause of women if U.S. empire is going off and killing women around the world? So, but yeah, I think women should have the exact same opportunities as everybody else.
All right. I know you have your views on the military and our country and everything else. If you could make some policy to solve these problems, and I know it might be something you haven't really thought about, what would be the one, two, or three things you would do to either, one, get us out of Middle East, or maybe perhaps generate world peace?
Well, I would start with ensuring that anybody who made over maybe $500,000 was taxed to 100%. And I think...
The 200% on the over 500,000 or...
Anybody who makes $500,000 a year should be taxed 100%. And I think money and inequality is what allows for these wars. And we're seeing the greatest inequality in the history of the United States, or at least since 1929, currently right now. Which, when you have this so much inequality, you have a very small percentage of the population making the decisions and essentially destroying democracy for everybody else. But if you have material balance, you know, not just in the United States, but across the world, then, you know, if my skin's in the game and I could die, I'm far less likely to say I'm going to go off and kill somebody or fight a war, an endless war. And everybody's going to have a say as to whether or not it happens. So I'm not going to say that's going to necessarily abolish war entirely, but I do think that fighting for economic inequality is the only way that is ever going to be like a reality.
It's always my problem.
Victor Galachenko, Paul Borak, and Pat Butler.
All right.
And then Mike Lehman.
Yeah.
Okay. All right, Victor.
Loud, please.
In your opinion and your experience, do you have any ideas? Why is it for us so easy to change regime in Latin America and so hard in the other part of the world?
Why is it so easy? Well, because there's a motivation. We go to Chile, you know, we see all this copper in the ground, and we decide a democratically elected president of Chile at the time, Arbenz, Allende, is going to distribute that copper amongst Chileans. And, well, ICT, you know, is actually taking all that to make their telephone wires, and so we're going to send down a group of high-paid hitmen to go off and take out the president and overthrow the government and put a dictator in. So we can decide, a dictator who's going to respond to our impulses, because he's been bought off, and that person is going to funnel all that copper to the United States as opposed. So there's a lot of profit motivation.
Yeah. Why is it so harder for us to do the same thing in other parts of the world?
What do you mean, what?
Regime change.
It's not. I mean, we went to Libya and we threw over through Gaddafi.
But look what we got. At least in Latin America, we know what we want and we get it. In Libya, in Iraq, in Afghanistan, we are not getting what we want. And it cost us plenty.
Well, there's the rule of unintended consequences and different, material circumstances produce different material results. And, I don't really totally understand the question, but.
Okay.
People love. All right, Paul.
And they know the history.
Yeah, given the fact you know what you know now about how the U.S. operates in the world, and the fact that Saudis were behind 9/11, it's coming very apparent that they backed 9/11. You think 9/11 was an inside job by the neocons?
I think there's plenty of evidence to show that U.S. what happened on 9/11 was a result of U.S. foreign policy in the past. Whether 9/11, I don't really worry about it, because I think we should feel indicted by what we've done as far as our foreign policy before 9/11, and as opposed to one single act. Because you can look at 9/11 and say, okay, let's just say it was an inside job, and you can kind of like isolate it and say this was just this thing that happened as a result of I don't know. I don't think about it at all.
Well, the fact that the document for the New American Century called for Pearl Harbor, and a year later we got Pearl Harbor and 9/11, it seems to follow all American policy typically.
I just think there's so much more to figure out about the history of U.S. imperialism that I just haven't had the time to even think about it, because that is a far greater indictment about the system and about understanding what U.S. imperialism is. To me that is, if I'm going to spend my energy thinking about the past or history, it's going to be about that kind of past as opposed to 9/11. And people may be right about it.
Oh!
Okay, Brown, we're going to have to take our last round.
Peter, did you get your question in?
Since every president has taken us into war has pretended to be a peace candidate, is it worthwhile for the average person to participate in the political process?
Under these circumstances, I don't think it's worth it. I mean, as we saw with the superdelegate system, with Bernie and Hillary, you're basically, two sides of the same ass at this point. And it's like, why different sides of the same ass at this point. And I don't think it's, I think the only change that's going to happen is when people flock to the streets and they withhold their labor on a massive level to demand what they can get. Because by the time you become president, as Gore Vidal said, you've sold your soul 10 times over. And maybe, so as far as electoral politics, I just don't think there's any viable candidates based on this current system.
Burr? All right.
Yeah. Getting back to a statement that you had made about income inequality as being a major issue, major concern, you're right on there. But do you see that as the beginning of a phenomena? We have the Trump phenomena. We have a lot of very discontented people out there. Do you see some kind of a social explosion taking place in this country? And where do you think it's going to lead, if so?
You mean a civil explosion? Is that what you said?
Yeah, social explosion. In other words, a revolution.
I don't know what the future holds. I just know that looking back at history, when you see such a gap between the rich and the poor, social unrest is all but inevitable. And, there was a glimpse of it with Occupy Wall Street, but if you're going to, revolutions, take time. And if it's going to happen, it's going to happen over the course of I don't know. I have no idea. But I do know that economic quality breeds social unrest. And the odds of something like that happening are very good.
What time is it?
Right now, Brahm, it's 7:30. We ought to, since we've had an extended question period, let's
get, they're closing the restaurant at 8:45, so Mike, you have just one last question.
Somebody up here asked if your pit is hit for the pit right? Was he shot, was he killed intentionally, possibly?
Yeah. I think there's still questions surrounding that. I think there's questions surrounding that. I can only say that I know it was covered up to the highest levels of the government. So,
so it could have been a hit.
Yeah.
A gangster hit.
All right.
My question was, it's a big, it's because of oil, right? Is that why we just have military in the Middle East? It's basically oil, right?
Yeah.
Well, that's why we're there to...
I'll just say there's plenty of dictators around the world that we're not interested in overthrowing. But if you know, it's funny that we're the most scared of people that live above the most, you know, the most expensive natural resources. So you know,
we go to war for oil. We go to war with oil. So okay, it's still true.
All right, we'll have.
Let's go to rebuttals, Brian.
How many people have remarks to make to the rest of us here? One, two, three, four, five, six.
Brom, let's allow 5 minutes, and if we have to squeeze it down because everybody else would well.
5 minutes.
All right, let's thank our speaker.
I'll give you a 1 minute warning. Let's get started. Excuse me. Okay, Brom, are we ready? Okay, let's get our rebuttal started.
First rebutter.
Do it even if they don't have any.
There's an open microphone.
Yeah.
I know Charlie's back there trying to scratch his head.
Yeah. No personal attacks.
You're not personal? Okay, what if we do?
That's the rule.
I find it interesting that Pat Butler opened the discussion up by asking if anybody foresaw a new American Revolution. Well, it's funny. The Democrats want to take your guns away so you won't be able to do it, and the Republicans want you to keep your guns so you could do it. That might tell you something. If you really want a new government, a new plan, much as I hate to tell you, you're going to need the gun. Because standing around burning your draft card, which you no longer have, won't work. So that's one point. Point two, they say violence never solved anything. How long did the Roman Empire stand? We're pikers for longevity, you know. And our speaker related to 2,500 suicide bombings since, 2003 or something? Well, it seems most of them were in Europe and Asia. They weren't here. So we're probably doing something right by convincing them that we might be willing to take the war to another level if they keep doing it to us. All I know is there really hasn't been too many successful ones here. But ask anybody in Paris or Brussels lately where they disarm everybody. Well, they seem to have very large body counts. If you're not willing to defend yourself and your country, you'll probably get what you deserve. In that case, it was a suicide bomber with an AK and a bomb vest. But if you're not willing to defend yourself, don't ask me for help, Charlie, when you get mugged and I'm standing there, because you won't get it.
That's why they have police.
You know, for Vietnam, I was drafted.
Not idiots with guns.
Well, they'll get you first, because I know how to duck.
Idiots from my neighborhood.
Charlie, one full lot of time.
Oh, we go back and forth, Charlie and I. He knows what I think. He doesn't like any of it. But it don't matter.
Because I do listen to him. I don't believe any of it, but I listen. I was drafted from Vietnam. I didn't speak Canadian, and I didn't have the money to run. And for anybody who thinks I just misspoke about speaking Canadian, most people in the 48 states down here think they do speak a different language up there. That's how bad the school system is. The illusion of JROTC in the schools here, there's a reason Chicago does it. It's cheap, and the federal government pays for it. The kids get uniforms, they get boots, they get coats. They don't get to do much. All three of my kids went through JROTC in Chicago, and the instructors are absolutely hideous. My son now, though, he recovered from their teachings. He's been in the Army now 12 and a half years. And his brigade, the Zord Energies, not for this coming August, but the August after this, to go back to Kuwait. So this is how far out they project this. They already know they're sending them back. For whatever reasons. But as to the JROTC people, it sounds wonderful. Because I've something to do. When my daughter was going to Lincoln Park in her ROTC battalion, JROTC battalion there, the battalion commander, which was an ethnic female, scored so low on the Armed Forces Qualification Battery, had the draft been in existence, she couldn't have even been drafted. Her scores were that bad.
Time.
So, I don't fear that. Pacifists who haven't really got a constructive idea, they worry me.
Hey, I'll go next.
Get the right wing out of the way first.
Everybody go out and buy guns.
5 minutes
or less.
You know, I hear our speaker's attitudes, and I completely sympathize with him on a lot of what he says. And I am in a real quandary about why he's saying what he's saying, because, you know, on the one hand, our military is being misused. We know how to blow things up. We know how to break things, and that's what militaries do. They kill people and break things. In a recent book done by a gentleman by the name of Thomas P.M. Barnett, he talks about and illustrates this very issue, and that is what we need to be better at if we're going to be in these foreign wars, is learning to rebuild nations. We, if any of you have looked at the Marshall Plan, what we did after World War II to Europe and to Japan, we were still fighting the Soviet Union and communism, and it was in our best interests to rebuild these countries. The first thing they did in Japan, which was very interesting, was they registered all the property. They took people in and they registered the property and put it in the hands of the proper landowners and farmers and everything along those lines. In a book called The Mystery of Capital by a gentleman by the name of Hernando de Soto, he said that's the beginnings and the beginings of what would start an economic system of revolution. And with the proper influence of property rights, you're able to start building a modern capitalistic economy. And if you look at the rebuilding of both countries, it wasn't, you have to remember, Germany did not fully get its independence again until 1955, 10 years after World War II. Japan's constitution was written again by Douglas MacArthur. And what we're failing to do in the Middle East right now is, you know, if we're going to go in, we better be able to pay the price to rebuild. And that is something that the Americans do not know how to do. Europe, in a sense, does, because the last real successful rebuilding program we had was in the Balkans in the 90s. There was a terrible war, but now you go through the area and at least you can get through peacefully. They remember the war is horrible, but now it's in a Europe area where you can maneuver and the governments are now stable in that area. I don't know what it's going to take to really bring peace to the world. But I do know that if America goes back to its 30s, where we're not engaged in the world, somebody else will take our spot. And that might not be as pleasant as what we say now with the empire of the United States. You see, I think as a nation, we're going to be the dominant power for the next 100 years or more. And the reason I say that is just because of the geopolitical nature of the U.S. We have full access to the Atlantic and the Pacific Oceans. We have virtual control of the air and the space around the world. And we still spend the largest amount of money in ever on defense. Now, I don't know what it's going to take to stop terrorism, but I do know that, you know, it's going to take enhanced security, more cooperation among countries and nations to, you know, help get rid of groups and things like this. And the other thing we have to do is, like you said, maybe there might be something to his arguments about economic inequality. But I also know, too, that the largest wealth-building system in the United States is the capitalistic system. And, you know, I as a person, maybe have a few good ideas that are around, but I certainly don't know all the answers. I do know that globalization, for the most part, has been a good thing. It has brought more people, more jobs by increasing trade around the world, and brought a lot more people out of poverty than any other government program ever could or would. Many of you may not realize that after 9/11, and the United States was so focused on terrorism, we brought almost two-thirds of the world back into the economic fold. And that is going to take a lot of energy to do, a lot of it. And I guess, you know, you've all known about my views on nuclear power, particularly thorium. And that when people get prosperous and make over $8,000 a year, they start, the stability comes. And energy does provide some kind of a stabilization influence when there are resources available. I really like hearing your viewpoints because it does point out the inequities.
I know.
But I'm also glad, too, that we can still voice our views in America with the First Amendment. Yes, I'm still proud to be an American. Yes, I'm still proud to live in this country. Yes, I'm still proud to be a proud owner and a good capitalist. And yes, I still believe that America is the greatest place on earth.
My first encounter with Veterans for Peace was in 1967. We held a rally on Michigan Avenue. Right at the time, I was facing a draft. I was 20 years old, and I was facing a big hassle with a draft. They now remind me about the little draft resistance. I think we got to get a, not just say, hey, we don't like war, it's ugly and nasty, but there's a military strategy, there's a military power, right? Logistics is 90% of military strategy. And I think we got to look into logistics.
Anything.
How to finance and take cooperation out of military finance. That's right. I had my hands with the draft and I was underground for about 5 years because of a judge issued a warrant for my arrest because I tried to get in on a draft case and tried to hide his bank holdings and about doubled in value since the escalation. But I think we ought to be concerned on a number of fronts. The financial front, the legal front, I'm glad to hear you got a book, Open Enterprise Publishing. I wrote a book, a 30 year accomplish. One-to-one condensation, it's also, I think, makes a pretty decent book. But I'd like to talk to you afterwards about that.
Okay. All right. Sid Cohen.
Yeah.
5 minutes, Sid.
Roosevelt had the New Deal, and it worked pretty well until about 1937, and then it started going down. And after we got in the war, the Depression was fully over. And before the war ended, or after it ended, I don't remember exactly, Dana Acheson, who was Secretary of State, made a speech. And he stated that if the war stops and we don't have no more war production, we'll be put in the same predicament that happened during the Great Depression. And that's when the Cold War started, because the industrialists and the bankers realized that if it wasn't the war economy, the whole economy would go down and capitalism could be over. So that's one of the reasons why we're still in war. Because without war, there is no profit. Like you brought out in Chile, under Allende, who tried to instigate a socialist government, and a mild one at that, the United States, with Kissinger as an agent for the Rockefellers, who owned a lot of copper mines in Chile, had to overthrow Allende. And we got into one war after another. We got into the war in Korea right away, and then, of course, in Vietnam. And now we have perpetual war. Well, if you have perpetual war, you need perpetual armaments. And without the arms industry, of course, the whole economy will go down. But what has happened, even with the war economy, the economy is going down anyways. And what is the reason for that? Because capital has run out of markets to a large degree. And so where does it turn for profits? It turns for profits by laying off people, cutting people's hours, even though they're producing more than ever. But the average person is making less than ever. And we got the worst economy since the Great Depression anyways. So if you look around you, and just recently they came out statistics that during the last 2 years, the average person's standard of living is going down anyways. So now when we're in a perpetual crisis. If you look at Europe, for instance, like in France, they're having demonstrations all over the place. And if you look at Eastern Europe, the whole economy is going down. If you look at Greece, Spain, Ireland, the whole world economy is going. So what has to be done is to have a more rational economic system so we don't go into these downturns. And especially now, when you have the danger of climate change wiping the whole planet off, we have to have a different economy.
Did we get a ride for?
Did we get a ride?
I'll
yeah.
Put it up.
All right, good. Thanks, whoever did
okay.
It.
All right, Mike Lehman.
All right, great speaker here.
Five minutes.
Or less. great speaker tonight. So I guess Eisenhower was right about the military-industrial complex taking over America. So that's happened. We're well into that future that he envisioned. Two things. You know, I've been thinking about Tim and how he likes to keep goods flowing and moving. And I'm thinking, you know, I think a lot of the military-industrial complex is in place in our great navies to, when I looked at the data, our imports, you know, most of our imports are oil and electronics and crap for Target and Walmart, you know, coming over in containers. So I'm thinking, you know, maybe they should be, Walmart and Target and Exxon and other oil companies should be paying more taxes, because it sounds like half our military costs are for keeping the goods flowing and moving, you know, so on our tax dollar. Makes sense? Yeah. You know, why are we paying taxes to have our military and navy all over the world to make sure we have sea lanes open?
Because if we keep the sea lanes open and the goods are flowing, we kind of help maintain freedom.
But then they should be paying for the cost of that, you know. So, you know, so Target and Walmart and the oil companies should be paying for these sea lanes in the military around the world. So, that's one point I wanted to make about globalization and oil and military. The other point I wanted to make was, you know, I kind of appreciated Ronald Reagan for one thing. When he did bomb Gaddafi's house. And I thought, well, that's a wonderful way to fight a war. You find a dictator that kills his people, that's dishonest, that is, you know, a bad guy, like a Saddam, like this knucklehead in Syria, who, I have a feeling he saw what happened to Gaddafi. He says, I ain't gonna let these fucking people take over my palace. I chase me out of here. So he wants to hold on to power as long as he can. But I thought, well, Ronald Reagan had a pretty damn good idea. You just bomb the real bad guy, the real bad leader's house, and let the people there sort it out. You know, some cruise missiles and what have you. And, you know, you might kill some servants and helpers and family members, but then we don't have to have troops on the ground, and you know, it's more economical, and of course the military wouldn't like that. They want us to have a big fat war. But yeah, I like that Ronald Reagan way to go with wars. You know, actually he was pretty good when it came to wars, and so was Clinton, kind of. But, so anyway, it looks like we've been through decades of oil wars, and we're going to keep on going, especially if Hillary gets in, and Trump, I guess, too. So, thank you. You were a great speaker. Went to the bathroom. All right, thank you all.
All right, next.
Pat Butler.
Butler, you don't want to torture.
Is this clean?
All right, Pat.
I have heard several people tonight talking about the fact that we need to have a constant state of war in order to keep the economy moving. We need to have a constant state of war in order to justify a large standing army. We need only look to the history of Rome in its better days. When the Roman army wasn't busy attacking the barbarians in Gaul and in Britain and in places north of there, including some of our relatives, I'm sure, they put the soldiers to work building bridges and roads. Some of those Roman roads that were built by the Roman soldiers in between campaigns are still around today. You'll see them still in parts of Europe today. They knew how to, unlike here in Chicago, when they build a road, 5 years later it has to be redone. When the Romans built a road, it lasted for a while. Fact of the matter is, we don't need to fight wars to be prosperous. We do need a standing army, because as we all know, if you want to avoid being bullied, you have to make it rather clear that the bully will attack you at great price. This doesn't mean go out and kick tail anytime you feel like it. It does mean if you're walking down the street and it looks like you're a bit of a psychopath who would kill anyone who would attack them, they're not going to attack you. They're going to go somewhere else. Same thing here. We don't need to prove ourselves to be the tough guy on the block. We've already done that. We now have to prove ourselves to be the smart guy on the block. Several people pointed out that after World War II, the reason the Germans and the Japanese did not turn on us and the rest of the world again was because of the fact we had the Marshall Plan. Compare that with what happened after World War I. Germany was left in a state of complete destitution. Even Woodrow Wilson, who is not one of my favorite presidents, by the way, but even Woodrow Wilson made the statement, unless a way is found to relieve the decimated parts of Europe, I can predict within a generation there will be another war, even greater. That came from Woodrow Wilson, who was a signatory to the Treaty of Versailles, which frankly, if I were a German, I would have been a little ticked off at the first place. They marched the Germans in. The Germans didn't even start the war, the Austrians did. They marched the Germans in, they made them sign this document without even reading it. They were not allowed to be part of any negotiations. Germany was to accept responsibility for starting the entire war, etc., etc., etc. That's not how you begin a chapter for the next generation. How you begin is to work the slate clean, rebuild, set up a new order, but a new order not based on anyone's particular greed. I'm not an idealist. Anyone who knows me for 5 or 10 minutes knows that I am a supreme pragmatist. And the surest way, to make sure you're going to have peace is not to have demonstrations and sing kumbaya. The surest way is to provide opportunities for people to make a living. If you are making a living, and a decent one, you do not want to start wars. Even in Ulster, which for several generations had been wrecked by war, as soon as prosperity began to rear its head in Ulster, after the signing of the Good Friday Agreement, you don't hear about bombs going off in the department stores there. You don't hear about British Army soldiers shooting people just for the hell of it. What you do is you see the beginnings of a prosperous country. What its future is going to be is anyone's guess, but it looks like it's not going to be as bloody of a future as its past was. We need to start thinking in very pragmatic, positive terms. If this means laying down with the devil, then we have to do that as a means to get something better for all of us. Again, I am not talking from a standpoint of idealism. I think we're all sick of casualty counts coming from the Middle East, just as I think we're all sick of casualty counts coming from the near west side. You know, we shoot more people here in Chicago than we do in the Middle East these days. We've got a lot of work ahead of us as a country. Whoever becomes president in November, whether it's Hillary or whether it's Donald Trump, they're going to have to get serious and they're going to have to forget their own campaign rhetoric and get down to realities. Good luck to them. I'm glad I'm not getting that job. Thank you.
Okay. It's 8 o'clock.
Pat Butler for president.
We got time.
All right, Charlie.
I got a lot of time here. That's good. All right, I'll be eclectic as usual. First of all, let's thank our speaker. I got a little early. Usually a lot of things. Great. And thank you to the organization, Veterans for Peace. I'm kind of dated, I guess, because when I think of Veterans for Peace, I was thinking Vietnam Veterans for Peace. And I saw this government, I said, oh, I got to adjust. There's other conflicts subsequent. Efforts for peace date back to 68, and I like to think in one fashion or another that I've always continued to advocate as part of the peace movement, so-called, for many years. Butler was there in 68, but he got scared and was climbed the telephone pole or something.
No, I climbed a tree. So they can watch you run out of the park.
Instead of taking on the Chicago Police Department. Anyhow, I'll be eclectic here. First of all, let's take care of my friend Joe, who thinks everybody should go out and buy a gun because there's Muslims coming to get you. And this makes
that.
This is a real good policy because of this inherent alleged danger of the Muslim terrorist in Chicago, Illinois. Well, he didn't see the literature back there that if the current spread of weaponry within our community has a result of 1,000 people in Illinois die each year from shooting each other needlessly. And he wants to increase this figure. I guess it's not low enough. He wants to make it 2,000 or 3,000 per year. Right, Joe? That's a good idea. Let's have more guns out there. So we can revise this literature here. Right, Joe? Good idea. Now, the guys didn't come here tonight, but I was talking to my friend Mike. We co-worker for many years, and he recently had to take in his nephew. His sister passed on, and he was steering his nephew into this ROTC and potential military career. And I said, you know, there are other options. And I contrast myself again with my friend Joe. About the same age, Joe joined the United States Army, and I guess he had a pretty good career. And I, at the same time, I joined in the War on Poverty and joined AmeriCorps. And certainly Joe had experiences in combat, what have you, but my experiences were being able to live on an Indian reservation and get to know the Native American culture. I also got exposure to animals. I was working on a dairy farm, and it resulted in lifelong pursuits of interest in agriculture and Indian affairs. Later worked with the Bureau of Indian Affairs. And as a result of my going, instead of going in the Army, I also pursued a degree in social work. So you by doing so, you didn't have to go into the Army as well at the time. So, in terms of alternatives to the military, I could say that my decision not to go into the military influenced my life in a very in a multitude of ways in which I am grateful. At least it was a catalyst for me and to pursue other things. Now, I'll jump to another topic here. My friend Butler here seems to think that we need to have a standing army and a navy because someone is going to invade the United States. Now, you ought to pick up this literature that I was passing out that said we would spend an amazing amount of 25% of the United States federal budget every year on military, and I think the figure's gone up from 27 to possibly 30%. That's a ridiculous amount of money. Do you fathom what we could do with 25% of the federal budget? Do you realize what we could do in terms of fixing the infrastructure and giving employment to people, and what we would have at the end of the day. What do you have at the end of the day when you spend money on this bullets and stuff? You have absolutely nothing. You have zero. You have zip. This is ridiculous. Now, do you honestly think that there is a country who can put together, I'm not a military historian by any means, but I do know the likelihood of somebody putting together landing craft and an air force and putting together an invasion of the east and west coast of the United States is a stretch of the imagination. I will be kind. That isn't going to happen. It isn't going to happen ever. Because there's no fucking country that could even do it. But we are preparing. You want us to prepare against it happening? This is ridiculous. This is so hypothetical, it's beyond realm. This is not what you base public policy on. It's strange concept. We couldn't invade Europe. Do you know what it took to invade Europe in World War II? It just took enormous amount of research, every effort. And even then, we could barely do it. But somebody's out there is going to do it. Who is it? Lithuania's going to do it? Name the country, please. That can even come close to thinking of this. Anyhow, it's not going to happen. But anyway, you gave us a lot. Thank you for your efforts in trying to cut this military thing. It's an ongoing thing. We have a lot of ideology out there, misguided, strange ideas, flag-waving things, and guys like this that want to keep ships floating full
and
of
the goods, are
goods made by children so that we can buy this
stuff. I never
said
that, Charlie.
Yeah, we need that. Anyhow, thank you.
All right, we still got an open time and an open mic.
Keep them boats rolling.
If nothing else, as moderator.
Go ahead, Brahm. You got 5 minutes.
You were listening.
Good.
I'll try to be a little brief.
All right. Since I became a CEO myself back in the 50s, and it was I got FBI investigation. You know, I was a kid. I had volunteered to be in the the Coast Guard because I too had a lack of imagination about what would be a good alternative to the cubicle. I wasn't quite ready to go to college yet. I didn't have the money. And in those days, it was a whole lot cheaper. And so I thanked Bernie for trying to restore that kind of economy where students can get a post-high school education for something less than what is charged today, and which is just unreasonable. But we didn't have the loan system. Defense Act,
GI Bill.
The name of the act.
GI Bill?
National Defense Laws.
National Defense Laws, right. But for that, you had to sign a pledge that you would defend the Constitution against all enemies and so on. Even the Constitution isn't that sacred to me that I'm going to bomb some little village somewhere to
see to it that that it's not changed. It needs changing. Most arrangements, human arrangements, need change and are not always going to get it, not peacefully. But there are peaceful ways of doing things. And Jesus taught people, he got his fishermen friends to go around healing people who were sick, paying their bills, bailing them out of jail, getting people to take care of each other, you know, cleansing the lepers, raise the dead, yes, and the people who have been written out of the family. Yeah, they held memorial services or wrote them off. They're dead to us now. They're no good. And he restored these people to their families. He got the dirty so-and-sos, the drug users of the day, the lepers and so on, cleansed, and they, it was the kind of work, you know, that we give to social workers and doctors and nurses and lawyers and so on. It's the kind of work that makes peace. He got them to be peacemakers, and until you're really active and extending yourself in peacemaking, you're not going to have a good reason not to be a war maker, and people are going to put you to work making their wars, if it's going to save them money or make them money.
Be a peacemaker.
So, Pentecost tomorrow. All right? Well, birthday of the
okay.
Church.
Be a peacemaker.
All right,
we got encouraged enough to speak up and not run away as they had when Jesus was arrested,
okay,
but speak out and continue the teaching of the work of Jesus.
Okay, next.
Anybody?
I'm going to take a second run at it.
All right, our
speaker. I'll take a second run at it.
You know, as I was thinking about it, sitting back and listening to the rebuttals, we do know how to make peace. And that's basically called development. I think for well over 100 years, we've known how to do it. And that is to increase people's material level of comfort. The first thing you do, get an adequate food supply in. We've had the agricultural revolution of the 60s. We know how to increase crop yields. The second thing that helps work is just the availability of electric power. When you're a woman in an undeveloped country and all of a sudden you get something like a washing machine or an electric light bulb, it makes a difference in your life and what it does. Third, you improve roads and transport. And you bring in, and these all brings in jobs. From there, you get together with the information technology in the country to get us, to get them up to a standard. And then you leave them alone to industrialize. Once you get to a certain level, which is about $7,000 per GNP, you start seeing kids from not becoming a source of labor and an addition, but they start being an expense. As that happens, our population goes down, which we're seeing vastly in all developed countries today. Our biggest problem, though, is that our full reliance on the system is on fossil fuels. The the whole reliance on our model of development is on the reliance of many other forms of environmental degradation. That's one of the reasons why I see a lot more better development for the widespread deployment of another form of nuclear power called the liquid fluoride thorium reactor. And again, if you can get all of your energy needs into the size of a material, of the size of the ball in this microphone, and it can be done cooperatively on a worldwide basis, I really think that we would see our world a much better place.
Anybody else?
Huh?
Did you say fluoride?
I'll tell you in a later. I'm sorry. I maintain that we do need standing armed forces for the same reason the city of Chicago needs police and fire departments. The United States is historically in charge after every war that it fought, even after World War II. And we saw what happened. Hitler got going after World War I. And consequently, it's necessary to make sure that we don't have to deal with another Hitler. There used to be an old saying, God protects children, drunkards, and the United States. Thank you.
Okay, let our speaker have the last word then. Take as much time as you need.
Okay, I'll be short. I'll be brief. Thank you, everybody. This is actually a refreshing little thing. I remember walking through Texas and finding this grain silo, and this guy invited me into the grain silo. He had 15 other guys around them. Every single morning, they sat down, drank fresh brewed coffee, and talked about current events. And I think that's kind of sorely lacking in our society. And regardless of what you think, a lot of really great stuff was said tonight. You know, some stuff that I thought was personally questionable. Fine, you know, the fact that there's a dialogue and, you know, we're talking, I think is really important. So, you know, keep it up, and thanks for having me on tonight. You know, as far as, you know, American exceptionalism. Yeah, I do think we're an exceptional in the fact that we have more people locked up in prison than any other country in the history of the world. You know, Stalin had 798 people locked up per 100,000 people. We have 802 people locked up for every 100,000 people. There are more people in jail right now than there were slaves during the height of slavery. There is plenty that is exceptional about the United States, and I think it's a little bit overstated. We are a country, a freedom-loving country, because there's a small percentage of the population that actually does experience freedom. We are way down the list as far as freedom of the press is concerned. I think we're at number 42 of the developed countries as far as what we can actually say, you know, out loud without risking jail. Just ask Edward Snowden, Chelsea Manning and the like. But statistics, you know, aren't a good way to end a talk. I think it's really important to just talk about and leave with a positive feeling, because, hey, we have to go out and actually do things. We have to do more than just talk. And I do think there's a really simple way to kind of like narrow all this talk down and say, hey, if I identify exploitation and if I identify oppression, if I identify violence, I realize that whatever benefits are gained from that are going to be extremely short-term and they can't be replicated. I think we owe it to ourselves here in this room, we owe it to the people out in the community to share the idea that if we see exploitation, if we see oppression, if we see violence in any form, we have to fight it and we can't benefit from it. And whatever gains are won are going to be very short-term. So thanks again for everything. I hope you guys continue to do this, and I hope other people replicate this type of meeting, because I think they're so meeting. So
yeah.
Thank you for your service.
Tip your
way. Oh, God.
And we're adjourned.
There's another 8 hours.
Okay. This is the best.